Hi everyone, welcome to first recorded presentation of History 458, the Civil War. I'm Phil Travis. I'm your professor for the course. I'm going to do these brief presentations at the beginning of each week. They'll typically range 10 to 15 minutes, but as those of you who have taken my classes know that sometimes I will go into greater depth. Today, I just want to give a brief, short presentation on some of the basic factors in the origins of the Civil War. These are basic. This is a general overview, and much of this stuff is drawn from your reading assignment for this week, Chapter 1 from the McPherson book. Also, by the way, that's the Battle Cry of Freedom, the big one. By the way, I know Battle Cry of Freedom is a huge book. And if you look at the syllabus, you'll see that you're asked to read selected chapters in the book. So you're not expected to read all 1,000 pages or however many it may be. But I selected Battle Cry of Freedom because it is the best book on the Civil War, and it is the most thorough book on the Civil War. And so I thought it would be a good kind of desk reference for you to have in the class and for the future. Okay. So first, I want you to take a look at this painting, which is by Norman Gast. Of course, it's a 1872 painting. It's titled American Progress. And of course, it's depicting Manifest Destiny of the Democratic Republican era, running from Thomas Jefferson through President James K. Polk. Take a look at this and think to yourself, what does this piece of artwork symbolize? What does it communicate to you? What do you see here? Well, you see a lot of the characteristics of the things that we're going to talk about today. Factors that are incredibly significant when it comes to the development of the Civil War. This pertains to developments in the United States, developments relating to industrial capitalism, developments relating to transportation, developments relating to the expansion of the country for economic reasons, as well as reasons of resources and territorial strength and foreign policy as well. It tells you a lot about how the United States envisioned its expansionist moment. In particular, I think it points out a few characteristics of America at mid-century, that Gast painting, that is. It shows that America envisioned itself as expansionist. It was expansionist, of course. Destinarian. It believed it had a destiny to expand across the continent against other peoples, Native Americans, that it certainly saw as lesser. It was Christian and Protestant. It was white. This expansionist tendency in the United States really began with Thomas Jefferson, who here is a famous painting of Jefferson. And it really began with the Louisiana Purchase. The Louisiana Purchase, of course, opened up a massive section of the continent as Jefferson purchased the Louisiana Territory from Napoleon Bonaparte of France, for an incredibly low price. And the territory pretty much doubled the size of the United States. The United States would, throughout the first half of the 1800s, have a significantly growing population as immigrants came to the United States from places like Europe looking to farm, looking for other opportunities, and the new territories opened up immigration out west. And you will see this immigration for pursuit of personal advancement. This expansion is a fundamental part of the ingredients that go into causing the Civil War. Another major area of expansion occurred during the presidency of James K. Polk, who was president from 1845 to 1849. And of course, Polk effectively instigated the Mexican-American War Mexico was a very weak, fledgling country at the time, had very difficult political situations. It could hardly control its territories of Texas and California. And, of course, the Texans had revolted in 1836, but successive presidents had refused to annex Texas. However, there was a great deal of pressure in the United States as Americans increasingly moved west into territories like Texas. And as these areas seemed more and more opportunistic in value for the United States, and Polk effectively incited the war with Mexico over tensions after he sent General Zachary Taylor to the disputed border of Texas. In the Mexican-American War, of course, the United States took pretty much all of the southwestern territories, Texas and California, or what would become Arizona and New Mexico. Polk also was responsible for agreeing a treaty with the British to demarcate, really, the Pacific Northwest territories with the current northern border of Canada and Washington State. Polk was an expansionist. He was an opportunist as a president, and he did feel that the expansionism was being demanded by the people, but that it was also in the best interest of the United States. And the United States very much took its manifest destiny in acquiring lands in the American Southwest for its own opportunity and its own gain. These types of expansionism really, in some cases, operated as a safety valve for coming immigration to the United States, but they also provided the catalyst for a major controversy in the United States. So this map basically shows you the territorial expansion from this era. You can see the huge territories acquired, and the expansion into these territories will immediately spark in the United States sectional crises that lead to the Civil War. The consequences of expansion, sectional tension over slavery. You might hear some people at times say things like the Civil War wasn't about slavery, it was about politics. It was certainly about representation in Congress, but these issues were always centered around the issue of preserving or limiting the scope of the slave system. So slavery was consistently at the heart of the causes of the Civil War. With each new state from these Western territories, there would be a debate over whether or not the state would be slave or free. And throughout the mid-century period, Southern states sought to maintain a balance in which there was no complete majority over slave states in Congress. And in particular, the Senate, by the 1850s, was the key for the Southern states because, of course, every state has two senators. And so Southerners believed that if they could maintain a balance of Southern slave states versus Northern states, they could always take action to prevent any kind of action that could prevent the continuation of the slave system in Southern states. The first controversy, the major controversy over a free or a slave state, came with Missouri in 1820. And this resulted in, after Missouri sought admittance to the Union in 1820, there was a huge debate and a fight over whether or not Missouri would be admitted as a slave state or a free state. Henry Clay famously was involved in the debate and famously created the so-called Missouri Compromise. And the Missouri Compromise basically demarcated northern and southern slave and free areas. According to the Missouri Compromise, Missouri, which had had a large amount of slave owners ultimately desire to move to the area, Missouri entered the Union as a slave state, but until that point, the southern border of Missouri, which was the 3630 line, would be the northernmost border from which a slave state could be. So Missouri would be this exception to the rule. They would be above the 3630 line and allowed to be in with slaves, but no other new state admitted to the Union could be above the 3630 line and have slaves. And so this demarcation really was, for until the 1850s, the kind of reference to whether or not states would come in slave or free. There was a second compromise after the Mexican-American War over California, in which California sought admittance as a free state. And Southerners and Northerners, again, fought over the admittance of California. Southerners created a compromise with Henry Clay again and Daniel Webster as well to allow California in as a free state, but to also have the legislation accompanied with a more stringent fugitive slave law. Slavery was increasingly, at mid-century, slavery was increasingly challenged by abolitionists and also free laborers. Increasingly in the United States, by mid-century, industrial capitalism, as we'll look at in the next slide, industrial capitalism was really transforming American society. And increasingly, you saw the development of wage labor. And the idea that all men, should have a right to work for a wage in pursuit of the American dream became a very, very widely held view, particularly in the Midwest and in the North, by individuals like Abraham Lincoln. And it became a primary ideological attack on slavery, as slavery in the South increasingly became a peculiar institution. It was a case of an institution that was based in bondage in a country that was increasingly being defined by free wage labor. Slavery was defended in the South largely as protecting white Southern economy and culture, meaning something like 75% of the Southern population did not own slaves, but yet defended the institution. And the vast majority of Southerners were not large slave owners. But also would defend the institution in the Civil War. And one of the big questions is, why did this happen? And many Southerners, the slave-owning status quo encouraged Southerners to defend the South in the slave system because of the belief that slavery was fundamental to the Southern economy and that it protected white Southern culture. So it's defended in the South as good, attacked in the North as bad. So expansion resulted in a sectional controversy over the tenets of protecting or even expanding the slave system, over those of promoting and expanding the free labor system. So as the country expanded, as it pursued this manifest destiny, it created increasing problems over the issue of the expansion or limitation of the slave system. And ultimately, in the middle of the 1850s, when the Missouri Compromise was effectively done away with, the new states of areas like Kansas particularly became battlegrounds in which Southerners and Northerners, pro-slave and anti-slave, actually did battle over whether or not new states would come in as slave or free. And these battles were in the broader perspective, they were about taking measures to either protect the slave institution politically or to take measures to slowly end the slave institution. So expansion leads to, it creates a powder keg in which sectional tension over slavery and free labor were carried out in the admission of new states. So expansion was like a safety valve in one respect. It created a place for immigrants to go. It created new opportunities in the United States. But it was also a place in which sectional conflict over slavery was really exacerbated to a point in which the nation ultimately went to war. Last slide. America at mid-century was a very new place when you were to compare it to the kind of agrarian republic that was envisioned by founding fathers like Thomas Jefferson and James Madison. During the mid-century period, you saw a transportation revolution with steam power if you look, think back to that gassed painting, you see the steam engines going across the open plains there. Steam power revolutionized transportation in the United States, and it revolutionized the economy in the United States. Steamboats used things like the Erie Canal that ultimately connected the cotton-producing South to the textile-producing North. So it was an economic boom. There was a communication revolution with developments like the telegraph. There was a manufacturing revolution with the development of interchangeable parts that was originally actually developed for the military for muskets, but became a revolution when it came to manufacturing in the United States. There was a growth of city jobs, textile jobs, growth of population, growth of wage earning. And very much this resulted in the birth of what we would call free labor industrial capitalism. In the South, farmers were increasingly specialized as well, and cotton became a very, very significant Deep South product. And actually, it came to be known as Cotton Kingdom. Cotton fueled the textile industry in Britain as well as in the northeast of the United States. And it became such a powerful economic force, the cotton industry did, that Southerners on the outset of the Civil War thought it would be impossible to wage a war against the South because international powers and whatnot needed cotton so much that they wouldn't stand for a war with the South. Of course, that was a huge exaggeration, but nonetheless, cotton became a huge industry in the South and a massive boom for Southern farmers. Of course, the U.S. North American slave population, which farmed this cotton, was very unique compared to other institutions of slavery in the hemisphere, because, of course, slavery in South America, in the Caribbean, had relied almost exclusively on the slave trade, which had been increasingly abolished in the 1800s, causing those slave institutions to dwindle and fade to and give way to cheaper or other forms of servant labor. In the United States, the Southern slave institution continued to function and grow because the slave populations were encouraged to form families, and the actual slave population in the South became self-sustaining. And so the slave system in the South was entrenched at a time in which other areas of the Americas, it was slowly and naturally fading away. And so the entrenchment of the South, of the Southern slave system encouraged Southerners to defend and fight and protect the slave institution, which it saw as absolutely integral to its economics. And it encouraged abolitionists and free laborers in the northern section to fight for its limitation and in many cases its end as a system. Mid-century America, by the way, also changed life for women. Women increasingly were encouraged, at least non-working class women, were encouraged to lead domestic lives. Workers and women both had their lives fundamentally changed by the birth of industrial capitalism. Laborers were barred, for example, from drinking at work. Laborers had to follow very regimented and strict rules and hours. These were all very new developments. They had to work in different environments, and these were new developments in life of American in life in America at this time. And women too, who had often fulfilled various jobs inside and outside of the home, were increasingly encouraged to take on domestic roles as men worked in the industrial capitalist system outside of the home. So you can see how expansionism during this time period, as well as an expansionism that was linked to other fundamental changes in transportation and communication, in labor and in manufacturing, how these all worked to create this sectional conflict in the United States. The Civil War is really caused by a polarizing sectional crisis in which one part of the country was fundamentally developing around free labor, industrial capitalism, and fundamentally developing around the idea of expanding the free labor realm and limiting and eliminating ultimately the slave system, while as another element of the society was far less industrialized in the South, relied largely on farm products like cotton and a slave system, and how these two fundamental differences clashed. And when you saw the country expanding and adding more and more states, these clashes were only increasingly exacerbated as Northerners attempted to take measures to eliminate the slave system, and Southerners took measures to either expand the slave system or to at least insulate it from its own destruction, which they saw as fundamental to their economic growth. And so expansion tied with economic growth and immigration in the United States also exacerbated sectional tensions in the United States that led to ultimately to the Civil War. All right, I hope this is helpful. Thanks, guys.